Kevin with the 2022 World's Top 16, six-time regional champion, which is amazing to see. 2023 NAIC top four, and that two-times top eight in an international.
Incredible accomplishments there from Kevin. And over on Esmil's side of the field, we've got the 2024 Dortmund top eight regional finish there. We've not got another top eight finish this year at the Liverpool regional, and another top eights there in the Stuttgart region on the Joiana regional over in Brazil.
Yeah, both trainers definitely not strangers to high level competitive play. And I believe Kevin does have his brother that's competing in the senior divisions too. That's done notably well recently. They're top four in Vancouver regionals as well as the LAIC.
Yeah, incredible. Performance this weekend from Kevin's brother, that 5-2 finish in seniors division, but it's all about Kevin going into this match. We can have a quick overview of the teams here. You can see on Kevin's side of the field, got that Urshifu, that is the single strike variant, the Ferrograph, the Fluttermane. We do have the Incineroar Orgopon and the Blood Moon Ursa Luna as well. We'll be able to touch a little bit deeper onto the teams in just a moment. Over on Ismail's side, we have the Torkoal, the Enamorous, a real big pick there. Blood Moon Ursa Luna, Urshifu, Ferrograph, and the Cornerstone Orgopon. But Kevin's team is up now. We can take a closer look at all of the details.
Yeah, Assault Vest Incineroar, not something you typically see, so I'm quite excited to actually see that interaction there. It does have the Grass Terra type in order to forego any sort of susceptibility to spores or perhaps even redirection, as Knockoff is such a great utility tool. But there is the Choice Specs Fluttermane, so something that's definitely not new to the meta, has so much burst damage potential, especially alongside that Ursa Luna Blood Moon. Mind's Eye, Life Orb, Blood Moon with normal Terra just deals so much damage to anything where it sort of neutralizes, resists to a certain extent.
Yeah, you've got some big powerful attackers here for Kevin on his side of the field. And the other thing to mention is that single strike Urshifu got that Dark Terrestrialization there, which is going to boost that Wicked Blow, already guaranteed a critical hit every time it goes into the opponent. And nice support options as well with the Orgopon there, with that Follow Me going to be critical to protecting some of these big hitters throughout this match.
Indeed, and the Huns making an impression, a little bit of a flavor text there on EUIC, both in juniors and seniors. I believe you did touch on that very quickly there. Christopher, Kevin's older brother, being able to get 5-2 in seniors, very close on being able to actually reach, make their way through to the finals.
Yeah, very close, and you know how fine these margins are at these tournaments. You've got to be flawless, just unfortunately missing out there on getting any further in the tournament. But a big shout out to the Hans family on doing so well this weekend here in London.
Whilst we do have the second opponent, of course, who is going to be Ismail. And rocking, like we mentioned, a very interesting team. Just from the get-go, I think we cannot ignore the Enamorous Therian form. It is Choice Specs. It does have that Overcoat ability, so it has a really nice way of being able to completely ignore any Spore-type moves focusing in on that slot.
Yeah, this is very exciting, because if the Trick Room goes up and you think, okay, you've got the Enamorous Therian and that Torkoal out on the field at the same time, it's going to be very difficult to deal with these big hitting Pokemon, because you've got the spread damage there from the Heat Wave, the Eruption from the Torkoal, and then kind of boosted by the Choice Specs over on the other side is going to be that Dazzling Gleam. The spread damage is very heavy there, also boosted by that Choice Specs item, but you've got to get the Trick Room up first. Yep. You do have some nice options though for Ferrograph there with the Trick Room, and then you do have Follow Me again with that Orgopon.
However, we at least know from Ismail's team, you don't have that immediate dual speed mode interaction, something like Kevin has options for. They both have access to burst damage. However, it feels like Ismail's team relies a bit more heavier onto the Trick Room mode. So that may sort of build up to an expectation of Ismail wanting to try to guarantee it being set up.
Yeah, I think that's one big thing that you can say. And here we've got the caption, taking to the International's final stage in the first year of competing, which is an absolutely incredible accomplishment.
I mean, Ismail being able to just do that is incredible, because it's sort of the fact that you want to try to build up on major events progressively over time. You know, naturally speaking, most trainers aren't able to find immediate success, but the sort of progress is based off of the dedication, passion, and, you know, real involvement with it. Just paying testament to how much effort Ismael would have likely gone through to be able to reach such a prestigious stage.
Yeah, and the experience just gained from getting to this point alone will be so valuable going forward in their VGC journey. So very exciting. Two teams, like you say, one side of the field, and Kevin got that burst damage, got that immediate threat. Mm-hmm. And then on the other side of the field, there is a little bit of setup there, but you feel like it could be done.
Yeah, and this is the first time that both of the trainers will be battling it out. So we don't have any previous experience, or at least they may not have any direct source of knowledge in terms of play styles. But I think given the matchup that we have in front of us, there are a couple of key points and factors to each of the trainers' strategies. So what would you say, Lee, is one of the key core components that either trainer will try to focus down on?
I think if you're Ismael, I think the thing that you need to really concentrate on, we touched upon it a little bit, is that trick room. You need to try and get it set up as soon as possible. You've got the perfect partner to be able to kind of help do that in the Aug upon the Cornerstone Mask, because you do have that sturdy ability. So you're guaranteeing being able to take at least one hit, use that follow me to protect the photograph and get that trick room set up. It's not as easy as that though, because if Kevin does decide to lead with something like the photograph on their side of the field, it does throw a little bit of a spanner into the works where they can counterplay the trick room themselves, but yep. Like I've already mentioned, it is quite risky going for a trick room to counterplay a trick room on the same turn. Yep. It might be safer going for the trick room the turn after that, while Ismael is trying to reposition, get some of those big hitters onto the field if that lead is kind of what he goes for.
So it could lead to a potential passive stalemate or at least awkward situation where you need to try to make that read and sort of anticipate what your opponent is gonna likely try to explore. But I think burst damage could potentially be name of the game. We could have a trick room setup alongside something that could hit the opponent's Pokemon really, really hard. That choice band, Urshifu over on Ismael's side is looking very strong in order to try to get that immediate damage off. However, we do have the Fluttermane choice specs, which is equally, if not stronger, and faster.
Yeah, and I think if that is the lead that Ismael comes out with here, you might even want to, that first turn, not remove the Cornerstone Mask from the field, because removing it, then if the Trick Room does go up successfully, you're almost allowing one of those big Trick Room Pokemon to come in and start doing big damage in return, utilizing those Trick Room turns. You kind of want to be able to deny that, so almost allowing the Cornerstone to stay on the field while you counterplay the Trick Room, try and stall it out, is maybe sometimes better. But like you say, Kevin has access to some big damaging Pokemon right from the get-go. The Fluttermane with the Choice Specs item, we all know how powerful that is. The spread damage, Dazzling Gleams, can be used to break that sturdy quite effectively, and then you could combine it with something like your own Blood Moon Ursaluna to do huge damage, or even the Urshifu, the single strike variant as well, renowned for the big work that that can put in when you bring it to a match.
Yeah, and game one tends to be a sort of scout potential match for most trainers, unless you want to try to go for any heavy reads, which most of the time do not occur unless you feel very confident or there's any sort of obvious pin that you could implore onto your opponent's strategy. So I will be quite curious to see what leads both of these trainers will likely try to opt for. I think you touched on it very nicely there. That Urgapon Cornerstone over on Ismael's side does have redirection. It doesn't have protect, which means that you can't avoid a fake out necessarily so, and you have to potentially risk breaking your sturdy, which could essentially be quite pivotal to your strategy.
Yeah, the one thing that Kevin might rely on quite heavily in some other matches against this kind of Trick Room core is that fake out. But when you're looking at Ismael's side of the field, has got that Frigoraph, it has got the Armatil ability, it is going to deny any sort of priority moves coming onto that side of the field. So it's something that you've got to really consider and rethink about how you would approach stopping this. But we are getting into this game one here.
Here we go, game one of the junior finals. Let's get it started. Urgapon Wellspring and Blood Moon Ursaluna over on Kevin's side versus the Urgapon Cornerstone and the Ferrigraph.
Yeah, the Cornerstone Urgapon here with that sturdy ability, gonna be a great partner, go for that follow me potential, but we are seeing a Terastallization come straight out this turn one. All go, as we see Kevin, go for that Terastallization on the Blood Moon Ursaluna. Going to be that normal Terra type, boosting those big normal type attacks. Could be a hyper voice here.
It could indeed, as the follow me will be coming out, getting redirection going, not wanting to jeopardize the Farigiraf setup of the Trick Room. Double follow me, another one coming out from Kevin's side, but Blood Moon being the focus here, quite nicely being able to target down the Ogre Pond. And Ismail, thanks to the sturdy on the Ogre Pond, even though there's a critical hit, it's not quite enough to pick up the KO.
Yeah, just surviving there. Two follow me's coming out, taking that Blood Moon. One thing we are going to see now is that Farigiraf go for the Trick Room, set that up. But the Ogre Pond on Ismail's side of the field in a really awkward position now where will go down, but that might fall into Ismail's favor here. Get some damage off if you can. If not, just allow it to go down. You've got to contend with this Ursa Luna, though, and the Ogre Pond here. If you are the Farigiraf, not wanting to take any damage, just going for the protect.
And Kevin's going into a sort of preservation mode of wanting to expire the amount of remaining Trick Room turns available in order to avoid Ismail capitalizing off of that, being able to bring in those heavy sweepers in Trick Room, but really nice touch there with the light screen in order to further mitigate the special offensive damage output over on Kevin's side.
Yeah, really nice. Light screen in particular, it's going to lower the damage of that Blood Moon if we do see it come out this turn. Obviously, the one caveat with Blood Moon is you can't use it consecutive turns, but that Protect there allows it to be fired off this next turn. We are seeing another Follow Me protecting that Farigiraf at all costs, but down to that one HP. Big Dazzling Gleam coming out, doing some respectable damage here as we see a Hyper Voice come out.
Hyper Voice is going to be dealing a lot of damage, but does not deal enough damage to two-hit KO that Farigiraf. However, we didn't see a Follow Me coming out from Kevin's Ogre Pond. It will be going on the offensive. It will be targeting down with that Ivy Cudgel. Not quite enough to pick up the KO, but this is quite nice for Ismail. They're able to finally have that slot opening up by the side of the Farigiraf in order to get some sweeping action under Trick Room going, as well as having the helping hand to further amplify the damage of this Ursa Luna that has now just been brought in.
Yeah, matching Pokemon for Pokemon here, and great Pokemon to bring in a Trick Room environment, because we've already seen it has got access to that spread attack in Hyper Voice.
Yep.
Also, if Ismail decides to go down the Terrestrialization route with it, it could power up some of those big attacks as well, boosted by a Life Orb, might I add, on this side of the field.
However, we do know that Kevin does still have access to Terrestrialization, and having Ogre Pond Wellspring is quite nice to be able to have that amplified plus one in its special defense, as we see the Farigiraf switching out for the Enamorous Therian form. There it is, it has been brought, whilst we have Incineroar also being brought in now, allowing Kevin to have that subsequent fake out pressure in the next turn.
Yeah, and we are going to see the Terrestrialization on Ismail's side of the field now. You've got to think it will be in to that Blood Moon Ursa Luna, going to Terrestrialize into the normal Terra type, boosting those Hyper Voices, boosting those Blood Moon attacks. Where will the attack be going into, though? Because potentially you're going to be able to pick up a knockout, but not into the Ogre Pond as the spiky shield comes out.
Ismail may be trying to go for the read there, but no, wanting to play a bit more safer, goes for that Hyper Voice. It will still be dealing a lot of damage. Ogre Pond is going to be able to avoid it. However, Incineroar is built quite different from the looks of things, being able to not even allow it to be that two-hit KO thanks to the Assault Vest.
Yeah, really clever item choice there from Kevin, and coming in really clutch here as it's not even down to 50% health. Coming in now, has access to that Faker, going to be able to slow things down a little bit more and get through these Trick Room turns. Doing very well at being able to handle that. But got to worry, if you do go for the Fake Out here, could the Farigiraf come back in? That Armor Till would activate, preventing the Fake Out, giving the Blood Moon another chance to attack this turn.
And there it is, it has been brought. So Ismail acknowledging that, wanting to be able to capitalize off of all of this offensive pressure that the Ursa Luna has in store. Armor Tail does activate, as the Fake Out did try to at least slow down the momentum, but no. Ursa Luna will not quite enough pick up the KO, but either of Kevin's Pokemon are so close right now, they will be taken off by just another attack in the following turn if need be. But Farigiraf is no longer available for Ismail, bringing themselves down to the final two Pokemon as Trick Room expires.
Yeah, the Trick Room expiring. Kevin doing a really good job to get through those Trick Room turns, not really take any big losses there, but removing the Trick Room setter, so it's no longer an option going forward. The Enamorus coming onto the field now. Kevin hasn't really got the offensive pressure that you would like at this point, because you probably are going to have to let the Incineroar Orgapon go down, maybe even Spiky Shield here, but get damage off is all that counts. Big Ivy Cudgel into the Enamorus.
Two-hit KO guaranteed, maybe with this double up. Enough as well. Enamorus is down. Kevin is really pushing this momentum pressure straight onto the Ursaluna. Ismail is only down to their final Pokemon as Incineroar actually goes down to the Reetwoyle.
Yeah, big, big attack there, and worthwhile trade-off as the Hyper Voice coming out from this Blood Moon Ursaluna. Going to be enough to pick up the remaining health on the Orgapon, but Kevin doing an incredible job, as well as Ismail, but is lacking that Trick Room now to really support that Blood Moon Ursaluna.
And we do need to make note that the Life Orb damage recoil is whittling down this Ursaluna's HP even further, as well as the light screen no longer now being in effect, which will allow Kevin's Ursaluna to deal regular damage, but there's an Urshifu, which is definitely not what Ismail wants to see.
Yeah, well, perfect combination to come in here with that close combat, and Kevin takes a clean game one here.
Game one for Kevin Han, trying to push through so they can get that title. And in what was a very direct way to stall out the turns of Trick Room available. It's sort of what we were talking about, Lee. Ismail has that situation for themselves that they benefit more from Trick Room being available versus Kevin's options being able to have a couple of Pokemon that can still operate quite nicely and offensively outside of Trick Room. You got the Urshifu, you got the Ogepon Wellspring, as well as that Fluttermane as a potential threat too.
Yeah, and I think the one thing that Kevin did really well was there mitigate the Trick Room turns, going for those double protects when, you know, sometimes you might think, oh, I'll panic a bit, maybe readjust, not panicking at all, really composed throughout the match, and keeping that Urshifu till that exact moment at the end, getting the really crucial damage off here in this turn one with that Blood Moon, taking the Ogapon down to that Sash, and meaning that it was be able to kind of be dispatched of at any point after the Trick Room went up, but not getting rid of it too quick, because you can then waste a turn of Trick Room. What I mean is that Fergaraf has to spend a turn really not doing too much damage either, and then it takes that extra turn where the Blood Moon Ursaluna comes on for Ismail and doesn't have the amount of turns that you would normally like to see to be able to utilize it.
And we did see Ismail with a really nice play there, bringing that Fergaraf in order to essentially be immune to that Fake Out, deal huge amount of damage with that Hyper Voice, but most crucially, it wasn't enough to pick up the double KO when he needed it.
But we are getting into game two. We are going to see Kevin lead off with that Ogapon and the Blue Moon again, and the same lead from Ismail with the Cornerstone Ogapon and the Ferrigarath.
So Ismail needs to try to at least get more benefit from the Trick Room turns, bring in their sweeper a bit more faster. So there may even be a scenario that we'll have to see whether the Ogapon is going to be allowed to stay on the field. Kevin figured out that if he at least breaks the Sturdy, keeps it on the field, he can sort of minimize that advantage for Ismail.
Yeah, we do see the Trastalization again from the Blood Moon Ursaluna, going to power up those normal type attacks going into this first turn. Will it be targeting into the Fergaraf to deny the Trick Room? Well, if it is, it's going to be pulled over to the Ogapon because it is using that big, useful Follow Me, and the same could be said from Kevin's Ogapon on their side of the field to just give the Blood Moon a little bit more protection.
Yeah, so far, the exact same pattern and lines taken from game one between both of these trainers. Interestingly enough, not even being able to bring it all the way down to its Sturdy this time round, as Trick Room has now been set. So the real question is, how can Ismail capitalize off of bringing in the heavy Trick Room sweepers safely?
There is the option here where you could maybe predict a double protect, maybe switch out your Ogapon into that Blood Moon Ursaluna to get it on the field, really punish that double protect, but there's always the risk that Kevin goes for an attack here, and you switch in your Blood Moon on the attacks, taking damage that unnecessarily was needed, you know, and you can try and just try get some damage off with the Cornerstone Ogapon, allow it to go down. You're not really taking full advantage of your Trick Room turns, but it means that the Blood Moon, if it is in the back, it's preserved a lot better than it would have been in other cases.
And you also have to think about, oh, here we go. Actually, it's going to be a switch here, a direct one. And it's actually going to be the Urshifu brought in here. We know it's Choice Banded. There could be specific training on this Pokemon to be able to take advantage under Trick Room.
As we are going to see a Hyper Voice from the Ursaluna here, going to take that Urshifu down to about 50% health, do some really good damage to the Farigiraf here. Ivy Cudgel coming out into the Farigiraf, going to do some big damage as well. Not quite enough to pick up the knockout, but the Urshifu gets in, has taken a lot of damage for its trouble.
It has. However, this is really the key moment on how these Pokemon have been trained in terms of their speed. Is this Urshifu really the best placed Pokemon right now to be able to bring in? Or was it more so a switch out of urgency in order to not jeopardize the true hard Trick Room sweeper in the back?
Well, we are seeing Ismail react to this with a translation of their own, and it will be into that Dark Terra-type Urshifu, boosting those Dark-type attacks even further. Will it be able to pick up a knockout before taking another round of attacks?
Ismail is going for it right now. Follow me. Being redirecting any attacks coming from the Ursaluna, but before then, we've got the Dazzling Gleam. Ursaluna does outspeed under Trick Room conditions, does pick up the KO on Urshifu, does not quite do so on the Farigiraf. However, we're in a situation where the resources available for Ismail are starting to diminish.
Yeah, and it's getting really tricky in this situation. This Blood Moon Ursaluna on Kevin's side is just doing so much damage each and every turn. You're not able to kind of get the damage in return, take advantage of these Trick Room turns. But things might change here as we do see the Enamorus introduced to the field.
Yeah, and I think there were two more turns of Trick Room still left to allow Ismail to try to capitalize as best as possible. We know this is Choice Specs Enamorus. Believe it or not, it deals a lot of damage. So this is this could finally be the moment that Ismail has been waiting for. However, the Ogepon is still available to allow any redirections of sorts. So it's going to have to really come down to Enamorus whether it can or cannot pick up a KO onto that that Ursaluna.
Well, Ismail is going all out with the helping hand to boost those attacks. The Blood Moon Ursaluna going to protect this turn, not wanting to take any damage from this Enamorus. Scout out what it locks into. Same can be said with this Ogepon, a really smart player here from Kevin. But what has Ismail locked into? It is that Dazzling Gleam.
Yeah, Dazzling Gleam makes the most sense. You want to try to capitalize off of that double spread advantage, especially when accompanied by that helping hand from the Farigiraf. However, we do have one final turn of Trick Room remaining, two turns of Light Screen, so this may allow Kevin to try to get some rotations going in order to further ensure the conditions for himself moving outside of Trick Room.
Yeah, we're going to see the Ursaluna switch out, and a nice safe switch to that Incineroar as well, bolstered by that Assault Vest that it's holding. Going to be able to soak up these special attacking answers that the Farigiraf and this Enamorus have. Another helping hand. Take advantage of the last turn of Trick Room here as the Enamorus fires off a Dazzling Gleam, doing huge damage. Not quite enough to pick up the Ogepon, returning with a big Ivy Cudgel.
Yeah, huge Ivy Cudgel, but more importantly, huge survival of that Ogepon. And we do have the Incineroar rotating in, taking a lot of damage, albeit being an Assault Vest variant.
Ivy Cudgel coming out again from the Ogepon, picking up a huge knockout here, leaving the Incineroar. If it does outspeed this Farigiraf, it's trying to go for the Trick Room, is going to be able to get the knockoff off, and it is going to pick up a huge knockout.
Huge knockout indeed, leaving Ismail down to their final Pokemon, being the Ogepon Cornerstone. And what magnificent plays coming out from Kevin, able to have that patience and try to sort of slow down all of the immediate pressure coming out from Ismail and further expire the Trick Room turns.
Yeah, and locking in with that Follow Me here just to protect the Incineroar, but the battle is cancelled. We have our first Juniors final in the EU 2024 Championships. Kevin Han!